Namaste everyone. Welcome to the Charvak podcast. This is your host Kushal Mehra. Today's podcast is a little bit of a last minute decision where I had to arrange everything and bring Srikant sir on. So first of all, I would like to welcome Srikant Telagiri ji on the podcast. Sir, thanks a lot for coming on the podcast.
Thank you.
So guys, today's podcast is going to be about three blogs, and in those three blogs, we're going to be focusing primarily on one blog particularly, which Srikant ji had written on the 19th of August. The blog's title is, and that's the title of the podcast too, it is called The Chronological Gulf Between the Old Rig Veda and the New Rig Veda. We're also going to be having a small discussion about two other blogs, one which was written by Srikant sir on 18th May, which was titled The Ikshvakus in the Rig Veda. And then on 9th of May, he had written another blog about the Varshagira battle in the Rig Veda. So, sir, I want to start with the chronological gulf between the old Rig Veda and the new Rig Veda. So, sir, let us start by maybe you giving us a base summary of what was the aim behind, because you have edited this blog, I think, 4 or 5 times and updated it, right?
Yeah.
So could you give us a bit?
But I think I'll put it in a book finally, because I keep on getting new words to add to the list, so it will never come to an end if I continue.
So that's the thing, sir. So what is the process? So what exactly are we doing when we are talking about? So in your blog, you have divided it into six parts, right? Where you call part one as the chronology of the Rig Veda as per the Western scholars. Yeah. Then you talk about the old and the new Rig Veda vis-a-vis the Avestan evidence. Then you talk about it. So, sir, could you talk about? So let's cover part one first. So when you say the chronology of the Rig Veda as per the Western scholars, what do we mean by that?
Well, see, most Indians, have a very orthodox view of the Rig Veda. They feel, many of them feel it's a divine book which has existed since the beginning of time. It is not written by human beings. It is divinely inspired or seen. I don't know what they mean by seen, but the rishis have seen them. And then they refuse to accept that you can analyze it historically or anything of that kind. So, actually, it is the Western scholars. They claim that it is those with a Western outlook who have no respect for the Vedas, who have divided it into different periods and said that this is old, this is new and all that. But that is not a very logical way of looking at it. Actually, the Rig Veda does have different, it was composed over a period of over 2000 years. Now, exactly how much over, I cannot say. Maybe 2500 years, or maybe 3000 years. And it was given its final form in 1500 BC, which is when I placed the Mahabharata. I and many other people, including Conrad Elst and many others, Dr. S.R. Rao, for example, and others. So that is when it was completed. It was given its final form. Now, after that, there were hardly any changes made in it. So, during that long process of composition of the Rig Veda, there were many periods during which the language kept changing. Now, I don't know if you see, on the internet, if you go and see a book, any book on the history of the English language, for example, you'll see how English was, say, 700, 800 or 1000 years ago. You won't be able to read a word of it. You won't understand. You'll think it's German or some unknown language. That's how different it was. Or you have the Nyaneshwari. If you see in modern Marathi, there's such a lot, vast difference between it. So you can imagine a text composed over 2500 years. Many changes must have taken place in it. But it is the Western scholars who, classified that there are the family books. The Rig Veda consists of 10 books, numbered 1 to 10. Of that, the books 2 to 7 are called the family books. And according to all the Western scholars, the family books were composed first. After that, books 1 and 8 were added to it from both sides. Then 9 and 10. 10 is the last one. Now, actually, the rest of the Rig Veda was completed almost by 2000 BC. But for 500 years, additions were made into book 10. So it is the appendix to the rest of the Rig Veda, actually, and it contains the latest kind of language. Now, to give you this, I usually give this one example because people know this word very well. you know, what is the word for in Sanskrit for night? You know, it is Ratri. It is used in all the languages. Even Kannada and Telugu have abandoned the original Dravidian word and they use the word Ratri. It is then all the North Indian languages, Rat, Ratri, whatever, different forms of that. Now, sir, people will be surprised to know that it is not found in the early parts of the Rig Veda. It is only found in the last parts of the Rig Veda, and then it becomes the main word in later times. In the Rig Veda, there are actually two other words which mean night. One is Kshap and another is Nakt. Now, you know that the Indo-European languages have 12 branches. According to all, whether you take it as an Indian homeland or you take it as a steppe homeland, according to all the people, you know that branches kept leaving the homeland and departing until finally only few branches were remaining. And of those, whether you take them to be in India or in the steppes or somewhere on the way, they usually agree that Indo-Aryan and Iranian were the two branches which were together after all they had separated from all the other 10 branches. So now you find this situation represented in this one word. For example, Ratri is found only in the Indo-Aryan branch. It is not found in any of the other Ilan branches. Then the word Kshap is found in the Rig Veda and in the Avesta. That is in the Indo-Aryan and the Iranian branch. So it represents the last stage of the unity between these two branches. And you know, Kshap is found in the Avesta. It becomes Shab in modern Persian. And we know it in Urdu. Shabnam, Shabba Khair, Shabbe Baraj, all that sort of things. So it is not found in any of the other 10 branches. And in all the 12 branches, you find the word Nakt, night, Latin Noctis, Russian Nosti, whatever. I mean, all those words are there. You know, you can check. I've given them in my article. Now, so you see, these are different stages of the Rig Veda. Now, when I was writing my very first book in 1993, it took around 4 years to research it. So I noticed that the people talked about, you know, new words in the Rig Veda, old words in the Rig Veda, and I was quite intrigued by that. I wanted to know, where will I get a list of these new words? And they had given such words, you know, like Kalpana, you know, the root Kulp, from which you got Kalp, Sankalp, Vikalp, Kalpana, all these words. That is found only in the last part of the Rig Veda. Or important words like Kalyan, Mangal, which are very much a part of our religious terminology now. Those also, and many words in fact are not found in the Rig Veda. They appear in the Atharva Veda and later texts. So you see, there is a definite chronology of the different parts of the Rig Veda. Now I wanted to know which are these new words, but nowhere did I get any text which has listed all these words. So actually during this lockdown, you know, I decided let me do that task of searching out as many words as I can. And the importance of this is because, you know, any question, any historical analysis, I'm not talking about spiritual analysis or something, but the historical analysis of the Rig Veda, this division into different periods is the most important thing. It solves all the problems and it answers all the questions. For example, when you say spoked wheels were invented somewhere around 2200 BC, you find that spoked wheels are the Rig Veda of the 10 books. Western scholars have given us this classification that 2 to 7 are the old books, then come 1, 8, 9, 10. But within the family books 2 to 7, there is one book, book 5, which is the latest. That is, has more affinity with the non-family books 1, 8, 9, 10 than with the other family books. So actually you get the Rig Veda divided into two parts, the old books, 5 old books, 2, 3, 4, 6, 7. And the 5 new books, 1, 5, 8, 9, 10. So this is the basic division. Any historical question, when you examine from the on the basis of this division, you get the answer. Like, you know, people were arguing, like there was an argument going on the internet that spoked wheels were originated in 2200 BC. And since they are found all over the Rig Veda, that means the Rig Veda was composed definitely well after 2200 BC. But then I said, no, you look, that was in 18 years ago, this debate. So I immediately pointed out, I went and examined, where do you find the references to spokes in the Rig Veda? And believe it or not, every single reference is only in the new 5 books. It is nowhere in the old 5 books. Now, this is one word. See, you cannot derive history from one word. You know, the Western scholars derived history from a word, anas. It actually means someone who babbles, who does not talk distinctly. But they decided it was an us. But they decided it was a nas, which means noseless people. And then they decided that, yes, the original Dravidians had flat noses. So they were these people called them noseless because these people had aristocratic Roman noses. So that was the way they derived a history from just one single word, misinterpretation of one single word. Now, so I got the chance, you know, when this question came of the mitanni. Now, you know, people say that the mitanni, according to the Aryan theory, the mitanni, the Iranians, the mitanni are actually Indo-Aryans. They belong to the Indo-Aryan branch. Now, according to them, the Indo-Aryans and Iranians came to Central Asia from South Russia, from the steppes. And then there they developed this common Indo-Iranian culture. After that, they separated into two. The Vedic people came to India and the Iranians, the Proto-Iranians, that is the Avesta and pre-Avestan people, they went into Afghanistan. And later they spread to the west, to Iran and all that. Now, the thing is that in my book in 2008, 12 years ago, the Rigveda and the Avesta, the final evidence, I examined all these common words, name types and other things, and I showed that the common, the rich common culture common to the Rigveda and the Avesta and the Mitanni is found only in the five new books. It is completely and totally missing in the five old books. Now, in the five old books, certain hymns have been taken out by the scholars as redacted hymns by the Western scholars. That is why I have given this first section on the Western, what the Western scholars have said. Now, they have given various criteria by which they have arrived at their conclusions. In my book in 2000, I had given many more criteria, all of which, in fact, confirm the Western classification. So, you see, this classification is absolute. Now, when I examine the Mitanni and the Rigveda and the Avesta, the data from these three sources, I found that all of it is found only in the new books. Now, if this culture was pre-Rigvedic in Central Asia, before the Aryans entered India, then it should be found in the oldest parts of the Rigveda, and then it should slowly peter out, you know, culture keeps changing. But in fact, it is completely and totally absent in the old five books, and it is found in the redacted hymns and the new books. So that has been the basis of my listing of the words since 2008. However, in this particular article which I wrote now, I decided let me go outside the ambits of the Avesta and Mitanni. Because within the Rigveda, it is the Western scholars who have decided. See, these words like Kalpana and Kalyan and Mangal, they are not found in Iranian and Mitanni. They're purely Rigvedic words, but they belong to the second layer, that is the new books. So then I searched out all the new words like that. Now, even within the old books, you know, there are the three old books, 6, 3, 7 in that order. Then there are the middle books, 4 and 2. So there is a vocabulary because there also there is a chronological gap. And in that middle period also many new words came into being. So then that is why my article has 6 sections. The first is, I have shown, see, this is the division of the Rigveda into 5 old and 5 new books. It is as per the Western scholars. So no one can accuse me that you are making up your own stories and all. This is what Witzel has even shown a chart in his book, one of his articles, which I have always quoted, where he shows how they were formed in these stages. Now, so what we are seeing is something which is as per the Western scholars' classification. Firstly, so it is not something we are going against them. So people can say, how do you know better than them? Then second thing is, I have given the Vedic, Avestan and Mitanni words, which I have always been giving since 2008 in the last 10 years. That is the next section. And then is the section on the new words, which there's a massive list of such words. As I said, as I keep on searching, I find more and more, but I don't know how many times I can keep revising that article. So I'll have to make it into a book where I will give the full analysis of the language. But in this section of the new words, you find that those new words cover every single hymn in books 8, 9 and 10. And it only leaves out 15 hymns in books 1 and 5 of the new books. So of the 5 new books, 3 of them are covered completely by these new words. And 2 of them are covered almost completely, leaving out only 15 hymns. And those 15 hymns correspond exactly to my classification of the Rigveda in the 2000 book as well as the 2008 book. Because see, book one is a new book, but it consists of many upamandalas belonging to different periods. Now, I classified in 2000, even before I had analyzed these words, I had classified that which of those were old upamandalas, which were middle and which were new. Now, exactly the 8 hymns which do not have these words, new words and middle words, they all belong to that old and middle category only. They belong to those upamandalas which I had classified as old and middle. So all the upamandalas which I classified as new, like 8, 9 and 10, every single hymn is covered by these new words. And book 5, as we know, is a family book. So it is actually older than the other non-family books, but it comes after the other family books. You know, means I said 6 books are family books, but of that, book 5 alone is a new book. So it is a family book, therefore connected to the old books. At the same time, it is a new book. So it is connected to the new books. It's a middle position. So there you find 7 hymns which have still not got new words. So everything fits in perfectly. So it gives complete evidence. There are around, 3,813 words which are found in these new books. And in the 280 old hymns of the 5 old books, not a single word appears even once. Mm-hmm. So you see, the gulf is so great. The difference between the languages is so great. Now, people know that, those who know, scholars and linguists and those who know Sanskrit very well, they know that classical Sanskrit is different from Vedic Sanskrit. You know, Vedic Sanskrit had tones. That is, it had a tonal system where every word has one particular one particular letter in one particular akshar in a higher tone called the udatta tone. And because of that, the word's meaning can change also if that thing changes. But that tone was completely gone even in classical Sanskrit, whereas it has been retained in 2 languages only today, in Punjabi and in Konkani, your language and my language, incidentally. So that is the thing. So classical Sanskrit is so different. You know, you think of the sound ala as something which is found in South Indian languages and Marathi, but Vedic Sanskrit had ala and even ala, ala plus h. So you see, it had even its sound system was different. Its grammar was completely different. And as I have shown, the vocabulary was so different that most of the words we know in Sanskrit today were completely non-existent in the Rigvedic language. So that is known to linguists and Sanskrit scholars. But within the Rigveda, that there is such a vast gulf between the old books of the language of the old books and the language of the new books. This is something that I had to show once and for all in detail. And as I said, more research will uncover more words. So it is absolutely clinching evidence.
So sir, so how did you come up with your own internal chronology of the Rigveda? Because So like the difference between you and the Western scholars would be the Western scholars go 2, 3, 4, 6, and 7, right? And then they go 5 as the bridge and 1, 8, 9, 10. But in your case, you say 6 is the oldest one, right?
Yeah.
Now, how did you come up with that decision that 6 is the oldest one, or why is your chronology? So you have come up with the internal chronology within the old books too. Now, how did you come up with that internal chronology?
Yeah, because see, they have taken 3 criteria. They have firstly divided the family books from the non-family books, because there are certain criteria like the family books are the hymns are arranged in a particular way. First there are the hymns to Indra, then there are the then the hymns to Indra, and that so on. Whereas the new books, they are not arranged in that way. Secondly, in the first old books, apart from the deity to whom they are addressed, they also arranged according to the meter and according to the number of verses. Mm-hmm. Whereas none of this is there in the new books. Then the language, as I said, the language of the new books, even the Western scholars had discovered so many words which show that the new books have different words from the old book. Now, the other criteria I used was, that before each hymn, the reciter is supposed to recite the deity, the Rishi and the Chandas, that is the composer, the deity of the hymn, and the meter in which that hymn is composed. Mm-hmm. Now, those composers, you know, you can arrange them in a certain order. Not every single one, but you can get the general order, because see, in some are composed by Vishwamitra. Some are composed by his descendant Madhuchandas Vaishwamitra. Okay. Another is composed by Jeta Madhuchandas, who is a descendant or son of Madhuchandas. So you know, yes, that the they come in that order. Now, if you take all the orders in the Rig Veda and you arrange them at the books, then you get this order, which I have come to. 6, 3, 7 are the old books, 4, 2 are the middle books, and 5, 1, 8, 9, 10 are the new ones. Now, another criterion is, within the hymns, there are references to people, and they are also related to each other. Like in the book, sixth book, there's a reference to Bharata, the very ancestral rishi of this, ancestral king of this dynasty. He's referred to as a person from the past. Then many of the ancestors of Devadasa are referred to.
Yeah.
Srinjaya and all that. Then Devadasa's son Pratardhana is also referred to. Mm-hmm. And so that is obviously the oldest book. The next two books, 3 and 7, are around the period of Sudas, who is a descendant of Devadasa.
Okay.
And book 4 is of the period of Sahadeva and Somaka, who are descendants of Sudas.
Mm-hmm.
So that leaves only book 2, which seems to be out of the this dynastic line. And a surprising thing is that fifth book, book 2, is not, Gritsamada is not referred to in any other book. And Gritsamada does not refer to any other rishi in their book. So it is a kind of isolated sort of book. So the first 4 are 6, 3, 7 and 4 in that order. Now, another thing is, you know, when they were making these books, they followed certain criteria. For example, these books are called family books. Now you see book 6 is composed only by Bharadwajas. Now Angirasas, Bharadwajas are a branch of Angirasas. Mm-hmm. The other branch being, you know, the Gotamas, and another branch being Dirghatamas. Now, all these hymns are composed only by one branch of one family, that is the Bharadwaja Angirasas. Now, the next one, Vishwamitra, the book of Vishwamitra, also Vishwamitra is there as the composer in every single hymn.
Mm-hmm.
But in one hymn, you find Jamadagni, who's a Bhrigu, not a Vishwamitra. He's a joint composer in 1 or 2 verses. So you see that someone from outside the family has made an entry into that mandala. Then you see Vasishtha, this thing, Vasishtha's book. You'll see the book 7, Mandala 7.
Yes.
You see that again, Vasishtha is the composer in all the hymns, but in some of them, there is a Angirasa, who is a joint composer of the full hymns with Vasishtha. So you see now, although in all these three books, the family of the book is composer of every single hymn, but you know, other families make an entry in 3 different stages. Now, yes, if you see book 4, which is next, you see it is composed by the Vamadeva Angirasas.
Mm-hmm.
That is the Gotamas. But there are 4 hymns which are completely composed by other rishis, and they are belong to the Bhrigu family.
Yeah.
Somavati Bhargava, I think. So you see, Bhrigu family is a different family, because according to the Rig Veda, there are 10 families, each with its own aprishita. So
yes,
these Bhrigus belong to a different family. So you see the all the 5 old books, they have slow loosening of the family grip, so to say. And then, yes, when you come to the new books, 5, 8, 1, 9, 10, you find that they are not family books. All kinds of families are there in all the books. And the 10th book, as I said, is the last one. This book, in fact, has so many hymns which you cannot even identify the family of the composer.
Mm-hmm.
There are fictitious names, or the names of the deities itself are given as the composers and things like that. So it was, as I said, it was an appendix to the main Rig Veda, composed between 2000 and 1500 BC.
Okay.
So you see, all these different criteria which are given, all of them actually confirm the Western classification, but only give it a more fine-tune that classification, so to say. As you said, the old books, you get the exact order. Now, you know, people had been rejecting this all the time, but now I think this particular article, it shows how, even before this, see, it is in 3 stages actually. First is the data I had been giving for 12 years, the Vedic Mittani Avastan data, which shows that the new books have a totally different vocabulary from the old books. Now to that, I added all this new, another section giving all the new words which are not connected with the Mittani or Avesta.
Mm-hmm.
And then I gave another this thing to show how within the 5 old books, there is this division between the oldest three and the middle two. Because there are birds which were came into being in the middle period, which are found in the new books, but they're not found in the oldest three books. So I think this, and in that process, you know, I added two more sections, as you must know, like people, Panchajanya, words like Panchajanya or
yeah. Yeah.
Or words like, you know, Saman, Samaveda, Yajush, that is the Yajurveda, and Atharvan. They are found only in the new books. Because, you know, the composition of those things that started alongside the Rigveda in the new period, though they were finalized at a much later period. The final form was after 1500 BC.
Yes.
But their composition had started during the new period itself.
So now let's go into the next part, sir, which is part three. I guess I can club it with part three and four together. So maybe two, three and four together, where you talk about the new Rigveda vis-a-vis the Avestan evidence. And then you talk about the new books and period and the new world. So what are we looking at in those areas?
No, it is the same thing. In that Avestan section, there are words which are in common with the Avesta and the Mitanni.
Okay.
Whereas these are new words which are not found in the Avesta and Mitanni. They are Rigvedic words only, but they were not part of the common culture. You know, that common culture, maybe they were more Eastern. The Rigveda covered a big area. So these must have been words developed in the Eastern parts, and those must have been words which developed in the Western parts from where the Iranians and Mitanni departed.
Okay.
That may be one explanation. Or it may be after they departed, words continued to evolve and new words continued to come into being, which were not taken by them.
Fair enough. So now if I was to, so let us now, sir, try and get a summary of all the evidence. And I want to keep the part six, where you talk about the three other Veda Sahitas and the four other tribes. Let's hold on to that for a little later. But now, if I was to take a summary of the entire evidence, so let me try and play the devil's advocate here. Let me try and my best to give you counter questions here. So what if somebody says that, but the Rigveda is 1500 BC, people came from the steppes, and the people who came from the steppes around 1500 BC, these are the people who got the Rigveda. So how does it matter whether it's the new Rigveda or the old Rigveda? So what do we tell to those folks? Because your date of the Rigveda is very different from the conventional understood date of the Rigveda. So why don't you explain to everyone how was that date of 1500 BC also come up with?
Yeah, the date of 1500 BC comes because, you know, there are two sort of brackets within which they want to bring in the Aryan invasion. First bracket is 3000 BC, because that is the period in which, you know, all the 12 branches have common words for, say, copper or for parts of the wheel and the cart and things like that, which proves that all the 12 branches were together in one place at that time, wherever that homeland was. And they started separating from each other and going in different directions only after 3000 BC. So if they want to bring the Aryans into India, they can't bring them in 3000 BC. They have to bring it much later. And the second bracket is the Buddhist period. We know the period of the Buddha. We know that before the Buddha, there were many dynasties for hundreds of years, covering the whole of North India, right up till Bihar and further. And it is all recorded because we have Greek texts, we have Chinese, and various other foreign sources also talking about all this Mauryan kingdom and before that, the Buddhist period before that. So there are these are the two brackets, 600 BC or so, and 3000 BC or so. So between that, somewhere they have to bring them in. Now they chose they saw that the Rigveda shows no knowledge of iron. So they said it was in the pre-Iron Age. And then, you know, when they wanted to bring them into India all the way from South Russia, it was a very long process, part of which they claimed was shared by the Iranians. So they had to account for all those different periods. They couldn't bring them over in 100 years or 50 years. They had to cover more than 1,000 years. And there had to be more than 1,000 years before the Buddhist period for them to have entered India. So it was like a sort of compromise date. But now this Avestan Mitanni evidence completely disproves it for a simple reason. That because according to their theory, the Mitanni are Indo-Aryans, right? They are not Iranians. Now, where did they separate from the Vedic people? Because they are found in Syria and Iraq, the big Mitanni kingdom, which was one of the most powerful kingdoms of that area. They fought with the Egyptians. They ruled a most major part of Iraq and Syria for over 150 years. So in 1500 BC or so. And that is the period when they claim Aryans came to India also. So how is it that Aryans came to India as well as to Syria, Iraq at the same time? So then, of course, they took a compass and, you know, drew that their favorite place, Central Asia. And so it was from Central Asia that they divided into two. One went to West Asia, one group came to India, and those were the Mitanni, these were the Vedic people who composed the Rig Veda. That is their calculation. But if that is so, as I said, whatever is common in the Rig Veda and the Avesta should be found, and the Mitanni, it should be found in the old books. However, it is totally missing in the old books, it is found in the new books. So which means that they did not separate in a pre-Rig Vedic period. Because if they did, then the common elements would have been found in the old books, not in the new books. The very fact that they separated in the new books and that there is such a wide chronological gulf, I want to emphasize that gulf again and again, between the old and the new books, which means that since they went in the new books, a period of the new books, that means the period of the old books was much older than the period of the new books when they separated from each other. So what about the period of the old books? As per their theory, they came from South Russia, from the steppes. So if the new books, they claim that they separated in Afghanistan or Central Asia, then the geography of the old books should be somewhere in the near the steppes. But on the contrary, the geography is completely to the east of the Saraswati. They don't know the western areas of Afghanistan and all. I have shown all that in detail with maps and charts and everything. So the old books of the Rig Veda are completely situated in Haryana and westernmost Uttar Pradesh. This is the area of the old Rig Veda, of the Bharata Purus. And that period, their language precedes the common language of the Avesta and Mitanni and the Rig Vedic, new Rig Veda. So that is one fact. Now, so when that means they separated from India, because in the old period, if the Vedic people were to in Haryana, obviously then in people who separated from them in the new period must have left from India itself. And if they left from India, when did they arrive in West Asia? You know, the earliest evidence of the Mitanni and the Kassites is around 1750 BC or so. And that time they were had already forgotten the ancestral language. There were only vestiges of that. You know, they had already become West Asianized, Hurrianized or whatever. I mean, they had accepted the languages and culture, but they had retained only the ruling clans had retained their ancestral Vedic culture. So which means that in 1750 BC, they were already old inhabitants of West Asia. If so, then when did they leave India and go? They can't have left after 2000 BC, right? They must have taken at least 300, 400 years to go all the way from here and then settle down there and become completely West Asianized. So if they left India before 2000 BC, that means that the new books, period of the new books starts well before 2000 BC, because the culture of the new books which they took with them had already become a part of their culture when they were leaving India. So that culture of the new books must have started long before 2000 BC. And then the old books go further back beyond that. And that's why I insistently referred to the wide chronological gulf. Because the old books are not just 5 years or 10 years or 50 years before the new books. They are hundreds of years before the new books. So that takes it back to 3000 BC, which is the linguistic date for the Aryans being together in their homeland and then separating. So even if I have already also given proof of the Anus and Druhyus, how they were in India and then they left and they are the other 11 branches. But even if that proof was not there, this simple fact that the old books of the Rig Veda go back to 3000 BC itself proves on the basis of linguistics that India was the homeland.
So, sir, isme, there is also always classical conundrum that they always say that, oh, but the steppe people were pastoralists and the Rig Veda talks about pastoralist people. But very interestingly, although I remember B.B. Lal in his book has, gone ahead and given detailed verses of how the Rig Veda actually talks about even divisions, like there is a Samrat, there is the Raja, there is a Rajan, and you know, the Rig Veda, yeah. I mean, I'm sure you are aware of it because you've done a far more detailed study. And then there are obviously the Rig Veda talking about docking and trading and stuff like that. Yeah. It doesn't seem seem like the Rigveda was a book of pastoralist people, but so in your view, is the Rigveda pastoralist, and if not, why is it not written by people who are pastoralists?
See, the Rigveda is not, is India today pastoralist, or was any country pastoralist at any time? You see, pastoralism is a part of the total culture. You know, there are urban aspects, there are pastoral aspects, there are sheep rearing aspects, all kinds of things. Fishermen villages, probably people living in forests and mountains. So what when they say pastoral, what they mean, I really do not know. And most important thing is, if they were pastoralists and they say that steppe pastoralists came to India and formed the composed the Rigveda, then did they abandon all their cows and cattle in the steppes itself, come here without any cattle for thousands of years, remembering the pastoral culture, come here and adopt the Indian cows native to this area, and then again become pastoralists? Because you see, not a single Western cattle bone has been found in India. The Indian cattle are completely distinct from the Western cattle. So whatever cattle are referred to in the Rigveda are Indian cattle. You know, it is the Zebu cattle, as they call it, Bos Indicus versus Bos Taurus. Now, Bos Indicus is the one which is found in all over that Indus area. And in fact, if you see the Wikipedia, you'll see there were two areas of domestication of cattle. One was in West Asia, around Turkey or so, and the second was in the Indus Valley. So that was Bos Taurus, which was domesticated there. And these were the Bos Indicus, which were domesticated in the what we would today call the Pakistan area, that is northwestern India, the Indus Valley, Harappan area. Now, isn't it strange that people should be coming all the way from there as pastoralists, and they don't bring any cows, and yet they are retaining the pastoral culture, and they're managing to reach another area, which is also the breeding ground of a different type of cattle, and then they make that their own pastoral culture. So this whole argument itself is so flawed, because the cattle of that area are different from the cattle of this area, and the only the Rigvedic cattle are all Indian cattle. So how do you say there's steppe pastoralists who have come to India and established their pastoral culture here?
So another question on the pastoralist aspect and the cattle aspect, which I actually find very interesting, is I think a few while ago there was even a paper, if I remember correctly, that shows the cattle movement was from a particular direction. I can't remember what exactly it was. I think the 8,000 years ago they have mapped the exact paper, because there are so many papers and you know I'm just blanked out right now, but it clearly showed that the movement of I think the cattle movement was in fact on the other direction. It was from India, the cattle had gone out there, and in fact, if anything, it disproves the Aryan migration hypothesis or the Aryan invasion hypothesis on the other way. I can't remember that. But one more question I wanted to address before I start taking other questions and we deal with the latter parts is the horse. Now, a common thing that everybody says is look at the amount of horse bones you find in Europe. Look at the amount of bones you find in India, it is hardly anything. How can that be the case if the if out of India theory is true? So what is your answer to that, Shikhanji?
See, when they talk about bones, why do they only talk about bones in that particular period, whichever they want to assign to the Rigveda? Because even after that, we know the period of the Buddha, the period of Rama and Mahabharata, all the epics and Puranas. They were also very horsey. In fact, there was more, if you see the Mahabharata, horses play a much bigger role in the Mahabharata than they do in the Rigveda. But bones have not been found. So what exactly is the logic? I don't know. And if the Aryans brought the horse into India, then you should see a trail of horse bones leading from the steppes into India. You don't find that. And secondly, if the Aryans had brought the horse into India, and the Portuguese brought many American fruits and vegetables and things into India. Like you have the chikku. It is called chikku in many languages. In many, it's called sapota. Now, both these words, you know, are actually Latin American words. They're not Indian words. Original Red Indian words, which are used in our Indian language. Along with the fruit, we borrowed their names. Now, if the Aryans had brought horses into India, why is it that none of the non-Aryan languages, the Dravidian, the Austric, etc., have borrowed any Aryan word into it? In fact, today, all the Indo-Aryan languages use the word ghotaka, which is... everyone says it is not an Aryan word, it is borrowed from the inhabitants. So if the your Aryans came into India bringing the horse. The natives who never didn't know the horse actually had verses for the words for the horse, and the Aryans borrowed a word from them. Isn't that very peculiar? I mean, what is the logic? And as for the horse, you know, it is true. Many people try to show that there were horses in India and there was some horse which apparently became extinct thousands of years ago. But actually, they say it must have been there and all. And some people talk about the number of ribs and all. I'll not go into all that. Let me just say very clearly, the horse, this horse is not a native of India. It is a native of the steppes and not just steppes in Russia. It is right till the borders of Afghanistan. It is a member native. And in fact, I have in my articles given the most recent articles which say that the oldest evidence of the domesticated horse is in Central Asia, just to the north of Afghanistan. And as you know, the Druhus had already migrated there. Then the Anus had already migrated there. So although they Anus and Druhus had all originated in India, they had migrated all over Central Asia. And all these languages kept on developing in contact with each other. You know, new innovations kept taking place. So obviously an animal which was so common there since 7,000 or 8,000 years, not 2,000, 3,000 years, that obviously would be known to them. But if you see the Rig Veda, it is in the old Rig Veda, the horse is very, very important because it is a rare animal. Why do you think in the Ashwamedha, you know, there are two aspects to the Ashwamedha. One is that a horse is let loose into another kingdom and which whoever tries to capture it, if he does not dare to capture it, it means he has accepted the sovereignty of the king who has let loose the horse. Now, why would anyone try to capture a horse? If you saw a dog be running around from another kingdom into your kingdom, would you try to capture it if your kingdom was already full of horses, of dogs, I mean? So it is because the horse was a rare animal of the north. So a stallion, you know, battle horse or something, imported from the north. It was imported from Central Asia into this Rigvedic area. In the old period, that is why it is in the new books that you find names with Ashwa and Ratha. All the names with Ashwa and Ratha are found in the new books. They are not found in the old books. Because it is, as the horse became more and more important, as you know, spoked wheel chariots came into being in the period of the new books. And then it became more and more important. So you see in the Mahabharata, you see this very great importance of horses and chariots. Because the Mahabharata took place at the fag end of the Rig Veda. So horses, you see, are not Indian. But that they're not being Indian does not prove that they were Aryans were not Indians. You know, we all eat all these, as I said, so many American fruits. So does that mean that those we also came from Americas or something like that? Means there was a point when these fruits were not eaten in India. So there was also a time when horses were not there in India. That does not mean that those people also came from the horse areas.
So as of now, the archaeological evidence for the horse goes like this. So I remember, again, Bibi Lal's book, he talks about who was that guy from Hungary, I think Budapest, Bokonyi, who had claimed that they did find horse bones. And there is kind of somewhat of a dispute on that. Then obviously in Sanoli, we have a case where we have found some bones. And I had Vasant Shinde, who he's the chief excavator in Rakhigarhi. And Dr. Shinde was saying that, again, on that also, one set of scientists say, we have found horse bones. Another set of scientists say we have not found horse bones. Albeit, I still take the point, and I understand where you're coming from, that the degree with which the number of amount of horse bones are found are not there. But interestingly, sir, when it comes to the spoke wheel, haven't we found spoke wheel samples in two Rig Vedic sites? They are mentioned with photographic evidence in Bibi Lal's book, Rig Vedic People. If I could pick out the book and go through it right now. I think one was in Banavli. It was in appendix 3.3, where they have seen spoke wheels, and one was in Rakhigarhi in appendix 3.2, where obviously these are terracotta wheels. And obviously there was one horse clay, I think it was a thing. And so it actually kind of goes more with your thesis, where because it was so rare that maybe the horse was showcased in a particular way. But now that we've covered the horse, I want to go back to the last part of your blog, where you talk about the three other Ved Samhitas and the four other tribes. So what were you talking about here?
See, people say, first the Rig Veda was people, of course, there are the orthodox people who refused to accept that these books were composed at all. They were all revealed in one go at the time of the creation, or at any rate, they were seen by the rishis at different times, but they already existed since the time of creation. So let's not go into all that. But generally people ask, you know, see, these Western scholars have said Rig Veda comes first, then comes Samveda. Actually, Samveda is not a separate text. It consists of, you know, hymns taken from the Rig Veda and set to music. Almost all the all the contents of the Samveda are derived from the Rig Veda. Maybe one or two few additional verses have been added. It is the Yajurveda which is the next important text. It deals with all the sacrifices. It even contains a prose section, like the Rig Veda is completely poetry. And then you get the Atharva Veda, which is a very completely different kind of language. And all kinds of other new things are there in that. Many of them, you know, are found in common with the 10th book of the Rig Veda. So it is not, you know, that first the Rig Veda was composed, it was closed as a book, and then they started the Samveda, then they closed it, then they started the Yajurveda, then they closed it. No, in the new period when the new books were being composed, at that same time, you know, they started using singing Rig Vedic verses as samans. They started codifying the sacrifices, and they started also the Atharva Vedic sort of things, you know, spells, incantations, or medicinal, whatever it is. If you see the Atharva Veda, there are all kinds of incantations, you know, how to kill a rival wife, how to kill an enemy, that sort of thing, or how to cure some kind of disease. So that is what you find in the Atharva Veda, you find it in the 10th book of the Rig Veda. So yeah, this is all, you know, but the thing is, they did not occur in succession, you know, one book was closed, then the second started. All were taking place simultaneously in the new period. As I said, it is only the old books of the Rig Veda which completely stand out from this whole mass of, you know, new books, Atharva Veda, Avesta, Mitanni, all these come in a later period. And the five old books of the Rig Veda stand in a completely different period. There's a wide chronological gulf between the two periods.
Now,
these words.
No, please go ahead, sir. Please go ahead.
No. So these words, you know, you see the word Saman, Yajush, and Atharva. They are found only in the new books and in the redacted hymns. So that shows that, you know, it was in the new period that all that composition had started. And of course, that second thing which I said about the Panchajana. You know, people, I don't know why, this is a big question, and many people object to that. Someone wrote, you know, that I have insulted Rama and Krishna by saying that Yadus and Ikshvakus were not Vedic Aryans. They were not part of the Arya Dharma. Now, what is Arya Dharma? What is an Aryan? We are talking like Nazis and Dravida Kalagamis when we talk about Aryans, as if they're a race or a community. There's no such thing as Aryans. You know, in the Rig Veda, and this name was given, you know, because in the Rig Veda, the people refer to themselves as Arya. The Bharata Purus refer to themselves as Arya. And in the Avesta, the composers refer to themselves as Arya. So because of these are the two oldest texts, people gave that language family the name Aryan. But then after Hitler, that word acquired a bad taste. So then they made it a geographical term, you know, Indo-Germanic or Indo-European. But they continued to call these two branches Aryan because they themselves called themselves Aryan in the oldest texts. But they don't realize that they did not call themselves Aryan in the modern sense of Indo-European languages versus Dravidian languages or something like that. It was, you know, and I always give the example because fortunately I belong to a community where I have the exact parallel to this. You know, among us Saraswats there in Karnataka, there are different groups, and we have a word called Amchigalo, means belonging to our community. So I will, if I see another person, I'm a Chitrapur Saraswat, I'll say this Chitrapur Saraswat, to Amchigalo. He's an Amchigalo. Now, Amchigalo is not the name of a race or a community or something. And a Gaud Saraswat, if he sees another Gaud Saraswat, he would have said, to Amchigalo, means he's a Gaud Saraswat. Formerly, Chitrapur and Gaud Saraswat didn't use the word for each other. Now we use it for both. It's become an inclusive term. And that is exactly the way, you know, the Aryans, when the Rigvedic people called themselves Arya, they did not mean that Purus were Aryas. They meant that they were Purus. They were Arya because they were Purus and it was their book and their community. And the Iranians in the same way. But the Vedic people would not have called the Iranians Arya, and the Avestan people would not have called the Rigvedic people Arya. Although they called themselves Arya. So you see, it is not the name of it is a word like Amchigalo. It means belonging to our community, belonging to our tribal conglomerate. That is the meaning of the word. So when you say Krishna is not an Arya, what does it matter if he whether he's an Arya according to this definition or not? Because you know that people who want to derive the whole of Indian culture from the Vedas, they think that everything else is later or it is an impurity. That is how the extent to which some extremists go, that something which is not there in the Vedas is a later impurity which has entered our religion and it should be removed. I won't go into that here. But even then, other people, you know, they just ignore this aspect. Like we do, there are so many, many, many things in Hinduism which are completely absent in the Rig Veda. In the Rig Veda, they only do yajnas, they compose mantras, and they pray to the nature gods, Indra, Vayu, Agni, Soma. They do yajnas, they do, and they, at a certain period of time, they also did Soma sacrifices, which later died out. Now, this kind of culture is found only among the Avestan people and the Druids of Ireland. And now, even the others, like the Lithuanians, now there is a group of them who have revived their pagan religion, and they also follow similar kind, because I have seen them. They had come for a conference in the north of Bombay, and I had been there. They perform a yajna kind of thing, which is the part of their ancient pagan Indo-European religion. So you see, this was the religion of the Anus, Purus and Druyus, which we find in the Rig Veda, the Avesta and the Irish traditions. Whereas to the east were the other Indian peoples, the Ikshvakus, the Yadus, the Turvasus and others, who had different things. They worshipped idols, they built temples, they all kinds of things. Whatever you see in Hinduism today, it is not something which has come later. It is something which has been there since the Vedic times. It is as old as the Vedas. And it was always there, but it entered the Vedic stream after the Vedic literature spread all over India. Like, for example, would you say America came into existence only after the Europeans went there and started writing about it? It was always there. Islanders have been there for 60, 70,000 years, they claim. But the earliest reference to them is in books published in London during the colonial period when they studied the Andamanese language. So are they English people? Before that, you don't find any reference to them in the Andaman Islands or anywhere else. So you see, you can't use childish arguments like this. So whatever, even the Jains, for example, they have a tradition that before Mahavir, who was at the time of the Buddha, there was a long line of Tirthankaras. The Buddhists have a tradition that there was a long line of, previous births of the Buddha. So you see, all of them hark back to a hoary tradition which goes back hundreds and thousands of years before the Buddha and Mahavira. So they are the old traditions of Bihar, which were not part of the Vedic tradition. So whether you like to call them Arya or not is irrelevant, because all these are parts of our Hindu religion. And we must accept that. No, we should not go into, use the Nazi or terminology and think that Arya name means good and other things means bad.
Yeah, so basically pretty much your conclusion is that the Rig Veda was the book of the Purus, written from the point of view of the Puru tribe and their interaction with their neighboring tribes. And I personally agree with that. And
that is
why
the word Purusha, Manusha means descendants of Manu. Now in the Rig Veda, they coin a word Purusha, descendants of Puru. Why not Anusha and Yadusha and things like that? It's only Purusha because Purus were there. They were Purus, that is it.
Yeah, so and just for the record, I do remember the name of the paper about the cattle. It was in scientific, I think it was in Nature Research. The paper was Adaptive Integration from Indocene Cattle into White Cattle Breeds from Central Italy. It was by Mario Barbato et al. And that basically said that European cattle have a substantial Indian cattle ancestry resulting from multiple gene flow events as old as 8,000 years ago. Just putting it on the record over here. So, sir, now let's, because you have mentioned the Ikshvakus, so now let's talk about the Ikshvakus in the Rig Veda. And obviously, you have written a separate blog post about that also. So you have divided into two parts. Part one is the Ikshvakus in the Rig Veda, and then you talk about something called the Northwestern connection. Can you give us a brief summary about that too?
Yeah. See, the Puranas contain all kinds of garbled information, so you cannot take them as the standard for deciding Vedic history. But they do contain traditions. You see, they tell us about these five tribes. They give us tell us where these five tribes are located. They give us an idea of all this. So Puranas can be trusted when they fit in with the Vedic evidence. Otherwise, the Puranas, as I said, refer to Yavanas and Romakas, who are Greeks and Romans. They refer to the Chola, Chera and Pandya kingdoms of the south, which came into being only during the period of the Buddha or after that. So obviously they cannot, and they pushed all these people into the Ramayana and Mahabharata period also, which is obviously much older. So you see, we cannot take the, because it contains so many interpolations of every period, you know. And I always give the example of the film Sampurna Ramayana, which was produced in the 60s, Hindi film. In that they showed, you know, after Sita has been carried off, Rama is wandering in the forest and he sees a Sita fall. It breaks open and he sees the image of Sita in it. And there in the Ashok one, she sees a Ramphal, and then that's why they are called Ramphal and Sitaphal, was the logic of the directors and writers of the film. And everyone must have swallowed it. And even the directors and all must have thought it, that must be it. But you know, these fruits were brought by the Portuguese. But the producer and director writers didn't know that. So whatever is there in their period, they just pushed it into the story, thinking that it must always have been there in India. So that is what happened in the Buddhist period, you know, all these Ramayana, Mahabharata were written down and constantly revised and redacted. So all kinds of things came into being which were not there at the time of Rama or which were not there at the time of the Mahabharata. So let us not judge those periods on the basis of these late texts or the Sampurna Ramayana film also for that matter. That's what I mean.
So essentially, it's actually very interesting, and I kind of get, because it's very interesting that in the Ramayana we talk about horse-driven chariots and a lot of things like that. Like when Rama goes to Dandakaranya, his Sutta takes him in a horse-driven chariot. I think it was 6 or 7 horses. I don't remember the number of horses too, because it is given in that much detail. So what we don't know is how much of the Ramayana is the original version and how much of these things are
exactly
that current reality imposed on the Ramayana itself.
Your question was about the Ikshvakus and the northwestern Ikshvakus. Now the point is, you know, that the Ramayana gives a list of the Ikshvaku dynasty, successive list of the kings, you know, and the Puranas also give such a list. And then you find some of those kings in the Rigveda. Now the surprising, and the common king is of course Mandata. Because you know, the Mandata is found in the Rigveda and in the Puranas. And Trasadasyu and Purukutsa are also found in the Rigveda and the Puranas. But Mandata is the only one who is found in the Ramayana. You know, Purukutsa, Trasadasyu, Triaruna, and the other Ikshvaku kings named in the Rigveda and the Puranas, they are not found in the Mahabharata Ramayana list. So why is that? That is because, you know, according to the Puranas, Mandata was a king whose mother was a Puru. So he was related to the Purus who were to their west. And he came to the aid of the Purus, which is also mentioned prominently in the Rigveda. He came to the aid of the Purus when they were facing enemies from the west. And he helped them. He helped his maternal relations. Now, after that, he settled there for some time and then he went back to Ayodhya. And then he started, his dynasty continued. But he had also left another dynasty in the northwest, which consisted of these people, Trasadasyu, Purukutsa and others. Now the Puranas just clubbed together all the Ikshvaku kings of the east and the west and then fit them somewhere into the dynastic list. However, the Ramayana gives only the kings of Ayodhya. In that part, it has faithfully maintained that list. And so that is the reason you find Ikshvakus in the northwest. Now, another thing is, you know, you find two rivers of the Ikshvaku area and the same rivers with the same name in the northwest, that is the Gomati and the Sarayu. Now they have nothing to do with Purus. So how did they reach in the northwest? They reached the northwest because it was this Ikshvaku dynasty which went from Ayodhya and settled down in that area, and they carried those names to the northwest. In fact, the Purana, which text I mentioned it, refers to Purukutsa's wife as a Pishachi, which is in the area of north, the Gilgit area, the much disputed Gilgit area now. It is in that area that his wife belongs to that area. So that is where they were settled. And even the verses which talk about him giving gifts to the, it is on the banks of the Suastu, that is the Swat, which is in that area. So you see that was a separate Ikshvaku dynasty which went to the north and they were allies of the Purus.
Yep.
But the Purus, so now he had no connection with the Vedic culture.
All right. So and no wonder they're not really mentioned a lot in the Rigveda too, right?
They were not Purus.
The proof. Yeah. Yeah, and it's quite clear because the Rigveda does not talk about any of these things, and it's quite clear Rigveda is just about the Purus. It's anybody who reads the Rigveda, I mean, I only read it after I read your book because I was like, should I trust Srikanth Talagiri or not? Let me go and read the Rigveda. And then I started reading the Rigveda and I was like, oh, damn, yes, it is like that. And so that's how it ended up for me. And then I completely related to you when you said, when I read the Rigveda, I was like, ye to Purus ki book hai. Ye sirf apne baare mein baat karte rehte hai. You know, it is all about them and their point of view, their worldview, their thing. It's always in like Purus are talking to you. Purus are talking about themselves. It is never about a pan-India culture in the Rigveda. It is quite clear from the Rigveda. So now, sir, I want to go into another blog that you had written, which I found very fascinating. So that, you know, and then I'll take the audience questions because I have them ready. So you talk about, you've written on 9th May about the Varshagira battle in the Rigveda. Can you can you tell everybody a bit about that too?
See, this is in the Rigveda, you find this battle, the Dasharatna battle, which is the main one. And it names 10 tribes of the Anus. And those tribes correspond exactly to the 10 ancient tribes belonging to 4 branches of Indo-European languages. That is Iranian, Armenian, Albanian, and Greek. Now, as per linguists, in the homeland, you know, there were 12 branches. All of them started living in different periods. And finally, only 5 branches were left in that homeland, which they place in South Russia, of course. And those 5 were Indo-Aryan, Iranian, Albanian, Armenian, and Greek. But we have no record that they were ever there. Whereas we have in the Rigveda the record that they were all there in the Punjab during this battle. On one side was the Indo-Aryans, the Sudhas and the Bharatas. On the other side were the Iranians, Greeks, Armenians, and Albanians. And then the book 7 is the crucial book in which they are driven west and they move west. And then they spread into Afghanistan. The Greeks and Albanians, Armenians move much further west. The Iranians settle down in Afghanistan. Then they start spreading into Central Asia and Iran and other areas, right up to Europe. So it was the starting point for all these western migrations of the Anus, which is the last 4 other branches other than Indo-Aryan.
So what would be the most significant aspect for us from the point of view, let's say if somebody was to say from an OIT or an AIT point of view, what stands out with this, you know, this particular battle, Varshagira battle?
That is because, see, this Dasharatna battle, I have dealt with so many times in all my books. The Varshagira I just mentioned in passing because it is found in the extreme northwest beyond the Sarayu, that is in the heart of Afghanistan. And now, this is exact, and this battle is important because it is recorded in both the Iranian records as well as in this Rigveda in only in 1.100, the 100th hymn of the first book. And it is found mentioned beyond in the battle beyond the Sarayu in book 4, because where it refers to Sahadev and Somaka, the descendants of Sudhas. Now, they were the one who carried forward their ancestors' battles into the right into the heart of Afghanistan. And they are remembered in the Avestan texts also, in the Shahnameh and in various other Avestan texts. Shahnameh is not an Avestan text, I mean, but it represents traditions which were maintained there, like our Puranas. And it is mentioned in Avestan texts that some the enemies included, you know, Humayaka, that is Somaka, and Hoshdeva, that is Sahadeva, because Saha will become Hosh, house in Iran in the equivalent. So you have these two names, and then all kinds of other references are there which prove that they are referring to that same battle. We say it is a battle between Aryas and you know, the others, the Dasas. They say it is a battle between the Aryas and the Turiyas. So for them, the Aryas are the Iranians. For us, the Aryas are the Vedic people, for the Rigveda, I mean. And the Rigveda calls them the Dasas. They call the Vedic people the Turiyas. So this battle is recorded. And up till now, I had never given much importance to, means I had not gone into detail about this. But then someone, one of my, the readers of my blog raised a very, I had written an article on the logic of Rigvedic geography. Now someone said that, and you know, I had gone by, M.L. Bhargava's book on Rigvedic geography, where he had identified the Sarayu with the Siritoy. Now, I always found it doubtful, but then I thought it's not important and I ignored it. Whereas, you know, people identify it with the Haroyu of Afghanistan. But when someone raised that point, I realized that something which I had been trying to put off, you know, because it would mean, you know, saying, yes, I have to change all what I have written in all these books. So then I took the chance and I made those changes. Yes, that Sarayu does refer to the Harayu. It was given the name of the Sarayu of the Awadh region by these Ikshvakus who went and settled there. And that is the Sarayu, which is mentioned as Harayu in the Avesta. And that is the area in which the final battle took place.
Okay.
So that is why in that article I have given all the details of whatever is required.
All right. So, sir, now
another article I must mention that the enemies of Sudhas in his battles. You know, all the time I have only been talking about his Dasharatna battle because it was important for Indo-European history. You know, those four last branches are there in that battle fighting with him.
Yeah.
But it mentions Sudhas moving east and west. So who, and it mentioned many other enemies of Sudhas who are not among these Iranians, Armenians, etc. So I decided, now let me go into all his enemies east and west. And when you see his enemies east, they are purely Indian names, you know, Matsyas, and I've given them in that article. Whereas the battle of the Parushni in Punjab, all the enemies have names of the ancient Indo-European tribes. So there's such a stark difference between, so that explains even these new words, you know, the new words which are found only in India, those which are found among the Avesta and Mitanni also. There was a area, a Rigvedic area spread out and probably had an eastern and a western dimension, so to say.
All right. Okay. So, sir, now I'm going to ask you a few questions from the live viewers who are watching this right now. So, yeah. Srihari has said, in Talagiriji's opinion, how strong is the evidence for out of India all the way to Europe? Also, what is his opinion about Dr. Semenenko's thesis? So, sir, Dr. Semenenko, I think, is this Russian archaeologist who has come up with his new paper, where he has said that actually the chariot that they keep talking about in Sinthasta is actually not a chariot, and the chariot is actually the one they found in Sanoli, but obviously he is one archaeologist, so we don't know what the entire archaeological evidence or the entire orthodoxy inside the science of archaeology talks about it. But then I'll still go back to the first question. So how strong do you think is the evidence for an out of India theory all the way to Europe? Now, I think what he's trying to ask you is, so we know from the Rigveda, we know a lot about the journey from, say, Haryana right up to, say, Iran. But yeah, there is a gap, right, sir? I mean, we know the internal European journey through archaeological evidence and through textual inscriptions, which is actually mentioned a lot by Mallory and Anthony in their books too. But the point is, there is still that gap. So what do you think? Is there a gap, or we can draw a complete picture, or you intend to draw a complete picture about these movements?
See, unless I acquire a crystal ball or I invent a time machine and go back into the past to see, I cannot tell anything about something which is not recorded. I cannot make up my own stories, and I refuse to do it. So let us say for so many years, for two centuries, people have believed in an Aryan invasion theory based on nothing. Based on no data, no evidence, just conjectures and this thing. And now that I have given proof, linguistic proof, textual proof, and many other kinds of proof, now suddenly everyone wants me to give a step-by-step, you know, a chart of the way they went. I don't have it. I will only tell as much as I can. If you can, if anyone can fit this, all this data into an Aryan invasion theory, let them try to do it. Because it only fits into an out of India theory. And that is all, as much as I can do. I cannot provide a complete, this thing, you know. I will not claim to be able to be knowing everything. Whatever I know, I have put into it. If someone asks me something, I know I will tell. But I do not know everything.
All right. So, Sir Sriram Prasanna asked, 3000 BC of old Rigvedic books period, which collides with Indus Valley civilization, then when has the Indus started, or if the new books are from, or, and are the new books from 2000 BC? I think that's what he's trying to ask. From the question.
No, the new books are definitely from at least 2500 BC, because as I said, the Mitanni people took that culture of the new Rigveda with them, and they are already there in 1750 BC in Iraq and Syria. They have they have already become West Asianized. Now, what is people's conjecture of how many years they must have taken to reach there? It can't be 10, 15, 20, 50 years. Also, it is, you know, backed by the fact that, you know, elephants, Indian elephants appear in West Asia. And I have given so many quotations in my article on the elephant, where all those elephants are found in carvings, in Egyptian carvings, depicting the Mitanni people who are presenting those Indian elephants to the Egyptian pharaoh. So they appear in Iraq only after the Mitanni arrived there. Before that, no archaeologist has found any elephants there. After they found these elephants and they tried to, you know, classify them as Syrian elephants, but they are Indian elephants. Then second thing is peacocks. You know that peacock motif. There is one article by some, I have quoted that article about the peacock in Mesopotamia and West Asia. It makes its appearance also in that same period. And now, as you said, there is this evidence. You said 8,000 years the cattle has started spreading. But actually in the West Asian thing, it has been found around 2500 BC. So you see, it is around 2500 BC that the Indian cattle, the Indian elephant and the Indian peacock start appearing in West Asia. So that is when they went. So if they went already taking the culture of the new Rig Veda with them. So when they were leaving India, obviously the new Rig Veda period had already started. And since there is such a chronological gulf between the old and the new Rig Veda, the old Rig Veda goes back much further beyond that. So 3000, I won't say 3000, it may be much more. It may be just 3, but it is at least 3000 minimum.
All right. Okay, so Sir Sudhindra has this question. He says, do you think the Vedas changed as per the ruler of the time? For example, in the Puranas, Prahlad is taught the Vedas even after Hiranyakashipa has subjugated the Devas and ensures all prayers are to him.
No, the Rig Vedas were Rig Veda and most of the Vedic texts were preserved as they were. So, you know, when the Europeans came, these texts were not written down. They wrote them down from, you know, listening to recitations right from Kashmir to Kanyakumari and Gujarat to Assam. And all the priests who recited these recited exactly, almost exactly the same thing. So that is why we have it in written form now. From if they carried it on for so many thousands of years without any change. Of course, changes have taken place, but they have taken place till 1500 BC. And after that, a few minor, there are five or six verses, I have mentioned those verses, which are added at the time of, which are not mentioned in the Padapatha of the Rig Veda, but they are found now in the present Rig Veda. So those verses obviously were added later. So there was not much change made after 1500 BC.
All right. So now
Yavanas and Romakas and Cholas and Cheryas in that also. We don't.
Yeah, true. So now Gaurav Chamania has asked this question, sir. He says, does the Rig Veda describe the Sindhu Saraswati civilization in the hymns and verses? Because I think he's repeating it. A lot of geography makes sense when you read it. So I guess what he's trying to say is that does the Rig Veda talk about the geography of the landmass that is this India, or does it talk about the geography of a landmass that is outside India? I guess that's what the question is, I'm assuming, because it was not very clear.
See, the total geographical horizon of the Rig Veda extends from western UP and northernmost Madhya Pradesh in the east to Afghanistan. And then I have shown in detail how the progression from east to west within this area takes place in the Rig Veda. So you see, nothing beyond the outside this area is known. Even Afghanistan, its rivers and its places appear only in the new books. Before that, it is all Haryana, western Uttar Pradesh, and then slowly, you know, areas of the Punjab appearing into the horizon.
Okay, two people have asked a similar question. I guess Santosh itself has asked. Santosh says, Bhimbetaka caves have horse depictions. So how does that fit into your theory of India not having horses?
Which?
There are caves called the Bhimbetaka caves.
Yeah.
They have pictures or depictions on the caves of horses.
See, this is a reference that I myself jumped eagerly at and I examined it. But the Bhimbetaka caves, you know, have drawings covering a large, right from 10,000 of years, I think, or 10,000 something, right up to almost the period BC. So which drawing is of which, and no one says that these particular drawings of horses are of that period. In any case, as I said, we know that the Dravidian languages have their own words for horse. So whether that was actually this particular species of horse, there were other species, we don't know. So we can only speculate on all these things, you know.
But yeah, and not only that, so the very specific horse we're talking about is of a particular equid type. And not only that, it is Yeah, and domesticated and non-domesticated horse. There are many other things. So we can't make out that just from a cave drawing.
And it was known from the very oldest part of the Rig Veda as a northern animal, a rare animal, which was a very highly prized. It was known from the very beginning of the Rig Veda, but it became common much later, like Soma, which is from the mountains of Afghanistan and Swat area and all that. That was also known from the very beginning, but it was a northern import, northwestern import. And it was only in the new period that it became very, very common. And by 2000 BC, it had almost died out. So in the 10th book, you see, it is slowly becoming a thing of the past. After people are not even sure what Soma is. There are disputes about what exactly it represents and all that. So,
one more question, sir. Sonu Kannan has asked this question. So I guess he was listening to your views on the Dasharatne and the other battle that we discussed today. Yeah. So he is saying that any idea, Talagiri, what are Talagiriji's views? Does he have any idea why these battles took place and why are they mentioned in the Rig Veda? He's talking about both the Dasharatne and the Varshagira battle, I guess.
Yeah. Well, it is a luck that they have mentioned them, because you see, there must be have been many other battles which they have not mentioned. And the thing is, why have they mentioned battles? Well, they were human beings. As I said, it is not gods who are dictating sacred hymns, you know. They were priests writing, sometimes criticizing rival priests, praising the kings who gave them gifts. Now, we know in the courts of kings how there are courtiers who praise the king for giving them gifts, and then the king gets so pleased, he throws some more gold necklaces at them and all. So, without going to that extent, you know, many of the hymns are of that kind. They're called Dana Stutis, where they praise the king for giving so many cattle or whatever to them. There are other one Dana Stuti, in fact, criticized the king, saying that he's very stingy, he has given less. So they were very, very human beings, the rishis. There are, in fact, there are many, I don't know if I should say this, but there are many hymns and verses which have not been translated by Griffith. He puts them in his appendix and translates them in that appendix in Latin. So because they contain some kind of extremely erotic things. So he, with his Victorian mindset, probably Griffith didn't want to use those words and all. So he translated into Latin so that only the scholars would read it, not the common people. So you see, every aspect of human life is covered by them. So battles are also part of that. They were not saints who did not do battle and all. They were not Ahimsavadis or something. In fact, as I said, Sudas in that battle, Sudas is not my idea of a hero, because he was a conqueror who was trying to expand his kingdom. My sympathies are with the 10 tribes who are being attacked in their own area by Sudas and his conquering tribes. So it's not necessary that we, that is one more point, but not pertaining to the Rig Veda. You know, we take our old texts and then we take sides and decide this is a good person, that is a bad person. You know, Yudhishthira was a good person, Karna was a bad person and so on. So I don't think we should take sides. We should be logical in our analysis of their motives or whatever.
All right. So, sir, just the last couple of questions. So, Love Suneja asked, why, when did the Vedic culture start mixing with the culture of the South? Was it peaceful or not?
No, I have written two blogs on this about the Dravidians. You see, the Indus Valley culture, the Harappan culture in its heyday, the mature Harappan culture is identical with the new period of the Rig Veda. Now, the center of the Rig Veda, as we know, was in Haryana and neighboring areas. But it extended afterwards to the whole of the Harappan area. But the Purus were not in those areas. There were the Yadus and the Anus. But they were part of that same culture. So you do not find as detailed descriptions of those areas or their culture as some people want to know why they don't refer to certain aspects of the Harappan culture, etc. But one very significant thing is that it mentions two words, Bekanata and Mana, which have been identified as Babylonian words. Mana is a unit of measurement. I think it is even used today. And Bekanata means a money lender. Now, both these words have been identified as Babylonian words, and both pertain to trade. You know, unit of measurement, a money lender who lends to traders. And that is because we have archaeological evidence that the mature Harappan culture had trading links with Sumeria, Babylonia, all those West Asian, Iraq and Iraq areas, basically Mesopotamian areas. So here we have this evidence, not in some later text, but in the new Rig Veda in Book 8. Book 8 is the one which refers to all this. Book 8 has some names in common with the Mitanni, K kings. Like, you know, there's a name Indrota, which is not found in any other text anywhere. It is found in Book 8. It is found in the name of a Mitanni king. So you see, they had a trade and contact with West Asia in the period of Book 8. And that is when these Babylonian words enter. Now, if that is the case, and in my article on the elephant, I have shown how elephant ivory was being carried by Harappan traders right up till the coast of Portugal. So if that is so, could they have been totally unaware of South India? Obviously, they were not. And I have shown in those two articles that there were Dravidian priests, people from the south, like, see, every sect starts in a certain area. But then people from all over India go there and take Diksha and become part of that cult or that religion or that sect. So there are people in the Rig Veda, there are composers like Irimbitha and Agastya. Agastya, you know, all those later stories about him going to the south and settling down. He was a southern rishi from the very beginning. He was a Tamilian rishi of Tamil Nadu. And his descendants came into the Rigvedic area and they became Rigvedic priests. And then afterwards, all these Puranic stories about him going to the south and all that came into being. So the name actually has a Tamil origin, not a Sanskrit one. And the Irimbitti, in fact, there is a place called Irimbilyam in the coast of Kerala. So, and the special thing is that there are, for example, two words, just like Bekanat and the Manar, Babylonian words. There are two words in the Rig Veda which are very definitely Dravidian words. One is Kana. You will use it today also. Kana means someone who is cross-eyed or, you know, his eyes are weird. Oh, Kanya hai. And second word is the Puja. Puja was with flowers. You do puja of a murti. This concept is not there in any of the Vedic texts. And this root itself, the root Puj, it is found only once in the Rig Veda. And both these words, Kana and Puj, are used by this rishi, who is called Irimbitha in one of them and Shirimbitha in another. So you see, Dravidian rishis had gone from the south and taken part in that culture.
Fair enough. So,
the important thing is that since the new books of the Rig Veda go back beyond 2000 BC, Book 8, etc. So this gives us evidence of Tamil before 2000 BC in these words like Pooj and Kana and many other words are there also. I've given a list of some of those words. See, before this, I used to resist the idea that Dravidian words could be there because, you know, they tried to fit it into the theory that Dravidians were there in the Indus Valley before the Aryans apparently came from out and then they conquered them, which is why there are Dravidian words. But it is not so. It is found only in the new Rig Veda and they were brought by these rishis who came from the south and became part of the Vedic culture.
Fair enough. And that's exactly what has always been the problem. I guess, you know, a lot of these questions, even today in the live chat, a lot of people have asked questions. And I notice a lot of these people and their questions stem from the problem that nobody understands the chronology of the Rig Veda. At the moment you understand the chronology of the Rig Veda, as you have described in your books with the old Rig Veda and the new Rig Veda, the entire thing gets clarity. Because every time these questions are raised, whether about the horse or about Dravidian loan words or about many other things, it is always falling into a trend where X falls into the old Rig Veda and the rest falls into the new Rig Veda. And I guess until and unless people don't read your books or actually go through them, they're actually not going to understand this subject at all, in my opinion.
The old Rig Veda is so different. It does not have any of these Avestan Mitanni words. It does not have reference to spokes, camels or donkeys. It does not have reference to these Dravidian words. It does not have those two Babylonian words. It represents a completely different pristine ancient area before this whole common culture came into being, you know. It does not have the word Saman. It does not have the word Yajushi. It does not have the word Atharvan. It is completely a different culture. And I have given that long list. Even the word Brahmana, it started only in the middle period. You see, so many basic words, as in the name of a priest, not as the name of a caste, incidentally, as one of the functions of someone performing a Rigvedic ritual. So you see, this the old Rigveda represents a completely different epoch from all the rest of whatever you are discussing, whether it is Mitanni or Babylonians or South Indians or Atharvaveda or anything.
Yeah. So somebody has said
I'll just point out that out of 280 hymns in the old Rigveda. I have given this in three sections. I have given long lists of words and how, where they occur. Not one of those words occurs in those 280 hymns. Whereas in the new hymns, out of 686 hymns, 660 hymns have these words.
Mm-hmm.
No, sorry, it's not 660, 671. 671 out of 686 hymns have these words. And out of the 62 redacted hymns, 51 have these words. Whereas out of the 280 old hymns in the old books, not a single hymn has any of these words in it, which will show the wide gulf between the periods.
So somebody, the same person who asked the horse question has said about the Dasharatna Patil, Talagiri sir said the Sudas attacked the others, but I read the other way around. I mean, I don't know where he has read and what. I mean, if one reads the Rigveda, it is clear as daylight who was attacking whom. So I guess, Tejasvi, you need to read the Rigveda, is all I can say. So, sir, before we wrap things up, what's next in your mind? So, any particular project that you're looking at, or you're going to dig further in this out of India subject?
Well, I don't know. Projects suddenly come up. Like, I had not thought of this until just during this lockdown period. All these, buried topics were unearthed and then given a complete renovated look, sort of. And this thing, which I had been after, this old new words business, is something which I took up just now. Then this genetics thing was my last year's book was about that. Then, numbers, when I was in school, I used to like to learn numbers in different languages, 1 to 100. I learned in all kinds of languages, Red Indian languages, African languages, Australian Aboriginal, all the European, Asian languages. At least in 100 languages, I knew numbers 1 to 100. And then I just written them down in a book. So now I decided, let me put it all on the internet so I can throw away that old notebook. And I put it up. And while doing it, I discovered this new strong evidence for the out of India theory in the Indo-European numbers. You know that blog of mine, we have discussed, I think, in our last
yes. interview.
You see, you never know what new thing will come out of whatever you're studying. At the moment, my only idea is that this particular article on this new and old, I intend to broaden it into a book, adding all kinds of other information about the Rigvedic vocabulary. That is all my right. present idea at any rate.
All right. Awesome. So, guys, I guess it's time to wrap things up. So before we wrap things up, I want to tell you that each and every blog that we have discussed on today's discussion, I have put a link for the blog post, Shrikant sir's blog post, in the description of the podcast. So if you're watching it live right now, or you're going to be listening to an audio version later on, or if you're watching this video later on too, just go on the description of the podcast, click on it, and you can read all the blogs. They're available, and you can even comment. And Shrikant sir is very open and happy to, reply to the comments. I've seen he replies to many comments on his blog post. Also, I would insist that you read Shrikant ji's book. So they are easily available on Aditya Prakashan's website. So I have put up a link for adityaprakashan.com too. You can just go on Aditya Prakashan and you can buy all his four books. They are available there. You can purchase each and every book. I insist, if you really are interested in this subject, you have to read the books. Also, if you want to know even more about this subject, you can go on patreon.com and become a subscriber to my Patreon, where I have not just covered Shrikanji's book, but I've covered B.B. Lal's books. I've covered Danino's books. I'm covering Mallory's book right now. I'm going to be covering David Anthony. I've even covered a lot of papers. I think the recent Narasimhan papers also we have covered. And we have covered multiple other things. We even tried to cover a lot of things that Tony Joseph has talked about, not just from Shrikant sir's point of view, but from other people's point of view also. Other than that, also, if you want to support this podcast, you can start by just liking this video, sharing it with other people, or you can become a member on YouTube. I guess I'll leave it at that. And on that note, I'll say namaste. Once again, Shrikant sir, thanks a lot for coming on the podcast. It's always a pleasure to talk to you. And I know this won't be our last conversation. I'm going to talk to you again and again.
Thank you.
All right, guys, take care. I'll see you guys next time. Until then.